welcome here. To all our visitors as well, a very warm welcome to you. It's always nice to see you visiting us. I see there's a few family members here today that visit us. So I hope that today will be a blessed day to all of you. It's a very special occasion today. We serve communion today, the Lord's Supper, and we know every time that we serve this, we experience the grace and love of Jesus Christ again. John 10, from verse 1 up to verse 21, the Good Shepherd and his sheep. The Bible in front of me, it is on page 951. Before we're going to read from this gospel, I want to share some background knowledge of the Gospel of John. So if we read Matthew, Mark, and Luke, the first three gospels, we call that the synoptical gospels. What does synoptic gospel mean? That means it's gospels with the same view. If you go and translate it more directly, it's the gospels with the same sight. So these three gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, is sharing more or less the same perspective of what happened with the birth and the life of Jesus Christ until the last day of his life on earth. So brothers and sisters, John is not part of the synoptic gospels. You will see John is more or less unique. John is giving us some extra advice. He's adding information to us so that we can understand the whole story of Jesus much better. And I want to invite you, go and start reading the Gospel of John. I am very excited when I hear that teachings of John. John is not the guy that really focuses on the parables of Jesus Christ. He is more into the game of learning, the doctrines, the big events that happen. So it's more or less, let us learn from what happened with Jesus and the people around him. Other thing that is very interesting about John is that John really focused on the glorification of Jesus Christ. So if you go read Matthew, Mark, and Luke, it is really teaching us and trying to give information about that whole path, the Via Dolorosa, the path of pain. But John is coming with an angle to say, let's focus on the glorification, that moment, that hour of Jesus when he risen from the death, that glorification, that time that made it possible for us to be saved. And then the interesting thing about John is most probably that apostle, that disciple, which was living the longest. Some of the old church fathers will even say he made it up to the second century. If you go and read the timeline of the New Testament and you see more or less when did Peter died, that was more or less 30 years before the death of John. So John was one of those disciples, those apostles of Jesus, which was really having this blessed life, sharing the gospel of Jesus. Remember, if you look at the timeline of the gospels, John is more or less the gospel that was written last of all the other gospels. So this is just an introduction to John. And I wish I have time to share more things about John, because I think John really understood something about the glorification of Jesus Christ, something that we're going to experience here today around this table, the Lord's Supper. So let us go and read this now together. The good shepherd and his sheep. Very truly, I tell you, Pharisees, anyone who does not enter the sheep pen by the gate, but climbs in by some other way, is a thief and a robber. The one who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep listen to his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes on ahead of them, and his sheep follow him because they know his voice. But they will never follow a stranger. In fact, they will run away from him because they do not recognize a stranger's voice. Jesus used this figure of speech, but the Pharisees did not understand what he was telling them. Therefore Jesus said again, "Very truly I tell you, I am the gate for the sheep. All who have come before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep have not listened to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved. They will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that they may have life. They may have life and have it to the full. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep. So when he sees the wolf coming, he abandons the sheep and runs away. Then the wolf attacks the flock and scatters it. The man runs away because he is a hired hand and cares nothing for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep, I have other sheep that are not of this sheep pen. I must bring them also. They too will listen to my voice, and there shall be one flock and one shepherd. The reason my Father loves me is that I lay down my life, only to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down and authority to take it up again. This command I received from my Father." The Jews who heard these words were again divided. Many of them said, "He is a demon-possessed and raving mad. Why listen to him?" But others said, "These are not the sayings of a man possessed by a demon. Can a demon open the eyes of the blind?" And this is the word of God. Brothers and sisters, the message of today is there are no two lines, there are no two rows of footsteps in life. And I want to take you back to your younger days, and maybe on Facebook you've read it the last week or whenever. And when I say this, I do not say it to attack somebody's idea or a way of sharing the love and protection of God. This is just a different direction that I want to use today to steer you in the way of think more of God and maybe differently of God today. I remember as a young kid, I grew up with that image of that beach. Just think about it. A beach, there was a moment that there's two rows of footsteps. And then suddenly there was only one row of footsteps. And this was all about that information and a message to say, if you go through bad times, remember, God will pick you up, God will carry you. And then suddenly, if you look back at your life, you will only see one row of footsteps. I think it's a really good message. I think there's something into that that we have to listen to and try to understand. But then, my dear brother and sister, I want to take it a little bit further. I never think, if I read the Gospels, if I read the Word of God, I never, ever see two rows of footsteps. I only see one row of footsteps if I understand what God is explaining to us. Why do I say that? And for that, I want to go to this message today. This message, this is one of the I am statements of Jesus. I am a good shepherd. Now let me take you to the history of that era, of that time when Jesus shared this message with the crowd in front of him. David was a good shepherd. There was really a time where there were good shepherds in the time of the Bible. But then there came a time where we will say, not all shepherds are good people. Not all shepherds are really a shepherd that we can follow, or that we can give our flock of sheep to him and trust him with that. So in the time of the New Testament, there was good shepherds and bad shepherds. So think about it. Even if you go to church history in this time, there's some church fathers, and there was one Jewish rabbi that was very prominent about it to say, but not all shepherds are good shepherds. And that time, the shepherds were that group of people that, first of all, mostly do not have a good job. It's not a clean person. So with all the Jewish laws, that's not really somebody that you want to touch. If you think about what they did, is they were just traveling over different fields of different owners with their flock of sheep. So they were actually thieves, stealing the grasslands, stealing the property for a moment of time. So in this time, if we look at the life of a shepherd, there was a lot of bad shepherds. Remember, this was not the time of David. So why is Jesus describing himself as not only a shepherd, but a good shepherd? Jesus was trying to raise himself to say, listen, this is who I am. I am a good shepherd. I'm not someone bad. Now let us go back to Luke 2. What happened with the announcements from the angels to the shepherds? The announcement to say, Jesus Christ the King is born today in Bethlehem. So just think about, where did they start with sharing the message? With the shepherds in the fields. Just think about it if you were going to read Matthew 1. Suddenly, in that whole structure of the history of Jesus Christ, there was women. It was not something that was allowed, but with this good shepherd, with announcing the good news of Jesus Christ that is born, with women in his background, in his history, there's something different about this Jesus, because he's reaching out to people that the Jewish people do not even want to touch, or people that they do not want to talk about. And this is why he is a different shepherd. And there's a lot of other examples that we can use. So Jesus comes and say, listen, I'm the good shepherd. I'm the one that's taking care of my flock. I'm not a hired man. I'm the one that's really taking care of you. Brothers and sisters, we have to understand the I am statement just before this part where Jesus said, I am the good shepherd. He said, I am the door. I am the gate to this sheep pen. Nobody will go to the Father except through me. Now, these words is coming together, and we understand it now to say that Jesus opened that gate. Jesus invites all of us, all his sheep. Remember, in this passage, he even say, you are my sheep, but there's others that I also have to go and get together, and they also will follow my voice. What did Jesus mean by saying this? Maybe because the Jewish people thought, the Israelites thought, they were the only children of God. They are the only ones that's going to be saved. And then Jesus said, no, I have other sheep as well. I will go and I will collect them and they will listen to my voice and they will follow me as well. Today we're going to sit around this communion table. Figuratively. Today we understand something about the Good Shepherd, which is a shepherd that opened the gates and invite all of us. All of us to say, you can follow me, you can believe in me, and I will take care of you. Now we are in COVID. COVID time, part of history that we will always refer to in the future. And if I understand this passage of I am a good shepherd, I understand that God is carrying us all in good times and in bad times. Brothers and sisters, if we look back at last year, some of you lost a loved one, some of you lost friends, some of you went through a tough time, some of you went through a tough financial time, tough times. But guess what? The Good Shepherd, which Jesus is, in those times, He carried you. But even in these times where we experience peace and comfort and joy and prosperity in life, guess who's carrying you as well? Jesus Christ is carrying you. And I want to read from Isaiah 41, and I want to read from verse 10. Just listen to this. And this is an old way of explaining who Jesus as a shepherd is. So, do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Listen to this. An Old Testament perspective of Jesus Christ, a John 10 perspective of Jesus Christ as the God who is taking care of us, that He said, I am here, each and every moment of your life. There are no two rows of footsteps. I'm carrying you through good times. I'm carrying you through bad times. And this is what we have to experience. This is what we have to experience when we sit around this table today. A God that is carrying me all the time. And I'm going to end this sermon by saying the following. What do I understand about a good shepherd? What do I understand about God today when He is reminding us of His grace? What did I experience the last couple of years? And I can say I experienced this in South Africa as well. I experienced this in the United States as well. That whenever we talk about the grace of God, we have to go to, oh, you have sins, and God is going to punish you for the sins. So the moment we talk about grace, the first thing that we go back to is, oh, God is punishing us. Remember, God is not taking sin really good. Well, you are right. You are spot on. He is not taking sin really good. He hates sin. But if we talk about grace, if we talk about the good shepherd, I hear a shepherd that say, the gate is open. I want to share grace. I'm not here to judge you. If you go read John 3, 16, 17, and 18, those that do not believe is already judged. But if you believe, my dear brother and sister, the gate is open. You will be able to follow Jesus and you will be taken care of. Sometimes when we introduce our gospel, our good shepherd to others, we start with the question of how. Let me explain this. How many times do we believe because we are afraid of going to hell? If you ask somebody, oh, I see your life is a little bit loose. I see you are not on a good path. Do you know that there's a hell? Or do you know that you are straight on the path going to hell? And if you don't realize that, I'm gonna make you aware of it. So because of that reason, you have to start believing. brothers and sisters, is I understand the good shepherd that gave his life to us. We don't start believing in by asking the question, are you on the road to hell or on the road to Jesus Christ? A good shepherd is the one that say, listen, let's start with faith. Let's start with belief. Let's start with what I am doing for you, what I did on the cross. And if we sit around this table of grace today, I beg you to go and teach it and share it to all the other people. Sin is wrong. Yes, it is. But if we talk about grace, I hear the statements of Jesus Christ. I am the bread that gives life. I am the light on your path. The second statement. The third one, I am the gate. The fourth one that Jesus is saying, I am the good shepherd. After that, I hear Jesus that invites us to say, I am the resurrection, I am the life. The next statement where Jesus say, I am the way, I am the truth, you have to follow me. And then the last one when Jesus say, I am the vine and you are attached to me. We did the prayer of confession today, didn't we? Your sins are forgiven. So when we sit around this table of grace, let's think about the glorification of Jesus Christ on the cross. That's what we have to think if we think about grace. Don't go, if you talk about the definition of grace and start with how God punished sins. Yes, God do that. But grace has nothing to do with the definition of punishment. If I read the statements of Jesus Christ, I hear a God that say, yeah, we all do sins. And brothers and sisters, are you a sinner today? No, you are not a sinner today. Do we do sins? Yes, we do. If we go and read John 1, what does Jesus call us? He called us children of God. This is who we are. Why do we say we are sinners? No, we are saved from the sin. We are children of God. We are saved by the grace of Jesus Christ. And that's what we're going to experience here today. The grace, being called a child of God, knowing that my life, in this time of Epiphany, have to be a reflection of Jesus Christ. Brothers and sisters, we need to hear the message of grace. And John is helping us today through this statement of the Good Shepherd. It's not a closed gate. Jesus say, here I am. You are my child, and I do know you do sin sometimes, but I will forgive you if you repent, but this gate is open. Come in. I hear the statements of Jesus. I am. I hear a God of love. I hear a God that says, come. Whatever you did in the past, whatever you're going to do in the future, listen to my voice. Follow me. Remember, there's always one row of footsteps in your life. That's a God of grace. That's the God that I want to worship. Amen.